Good morning and welcome to Hillhurst United Church. My name is John Pentland, and a safe 6 feet away is Sarah Elliott, our communications person on staff. We're so glad you're here today. We decided to be safe so you can actually see our faces as we share good news about our church. There's a banner up front that says, whoever you are, wherever you're at, join us on the journey. And so we're glad you're joining us, whether you're in Calgary or another part of the country or indeed around the world. There are four practices, and the first is hospitality. Sarah, tell us something about that this week.
Hospitality, you know, it's been a bit of a challenge during the pandemic to live into our value of hospitality when you aren't here in the sanctuary. But something that we're doing with our new music and arts worship, what is this title?
Animator, arts animator, artist in
residence. Jesse Peters, you've met him. He's the artist in residence.
There you go.
Bit of a long title, but we're really excited that we're going to be engaging with our online audience and trying to live into hospitality and spirituality with a new series called Live from the Loft, where Jesse is going to be on his piano in the choir loft, live on Facebook on Wednesday evenings at 7 p.m. And he's going to be taking your requests and he's going to be engaging with you in the comments and playing lots of music. And it's going to be really fun.
Nice. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's hospitality. Also, hospitality is eating and drinking together. We trust you have your right beverage, whether you're Sunday morning or Tuesday night or the middle of the night on Thursday, who knows? We hope you have the right hospitality. You know, I saw some great hospitality of the church. The outreach cupboard that's outside has food. Several times this week, I bumped into people who are actually either donating food or using food. That's hospitality to people in a very difficult time. So I want to thank you if you're able to bring food down to be shared, or you need it, you're most welcome to it. The second practice here is spirituality. And we've had to delay our spiritual nurture program, which will start
delays, for sure,
tomorrow night, as we look at the hero's journey. We're going to look at how you are and we are heroes. We're going to look at long haul heroes. We're going to look at the hero's journey. And so from 7 to 8:30, tomorrow night, join us. If you've never been, come, bring a friend. If you've been here before and you've been anxiously waiting, it's tomorrow night, Monday at 7 o'clock. So the hero's journey. Go to hillhurstunited.live.
Yes.
Social justice.
Social justice. So right now we are participating in 40 days of engaging with anti-racism, which is something that the National United Church of Canada is doing. So every single Tuesday, there's a free webinar that you can go to. Just go to hillhurstunited.life to find the link to the United Church of Canada's website. And they're a really amazing resource for engaging with anti-racism. This Tuesday, it's at 5 p.m. and it's about youth's involvement with anti-racism.
Nice. You know, we just come through an election in our city, and it was a risk for people to come out and vote, but they did. And I'm super excited about the new council and the new mayors, both in Edmonton and in Calgary. Alberta is in it for the long haul. And we're so excited as we give thanks for those who served before and those who are going to step into new work this week as we seek to be a province that is about compassion and peace and justice. And so I'm super excited as we move into this new week. So thanks for joining us at Hillhurst United Church, and we hope you enjoy the service.
Good morning and welcome. I'm Keith Murray, the Affirming Coordinator here, and I'm so excited to worship with you this morning and to tell you a little bit more about who we are. Hillhurst United Church is an affirming community of faith. What does that mean? It means we follow in the way of Jesus under a banner outside that says, whoever you are, wherever you're at, join us on the journey. This means that we value the sacred worth of all people, whatever your age, your gender identity or expression, your sexual orientation, your race or racialized experience, whatever your ability, your health status, religious or ethnic background, or economic circumstance, know that you're a part of this community, and we are so excited to worship with you this morning. We are also a community that acknowledges the land on which we worship and the long history of the church's role in the implicit genocide of the First Peoples of Canada. We are a church that is committed to righting the wrongs of the past and to working towards better relationship as treaty people with all of the nations and peoples here, including the Siksika, Piikani and Kainai, members of the Blackfoot Confederacy, the Stoney Nakota, Oyarhe Nakota people, the Wesley Chiniki and Bearspaw First Nations, and the Sutina First Nation. This is also the land where Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3 calls home, and is a place where many people from all over the world are gathering, and we are so excited to gather with you and to work together in the spirit of kinship, of friendship, to make this an equitable place for all. One of the ways that we're doing that is by stepping in to 40 days of engagement with anti-racism in the United Church of Canada. And you can get involved in that too. There's lots of events and workshops, and we're having conversations on Facebook. Go to hillhurstunited.life for more information about how you can participate in that and engage with our values as a community of faith that walks in the way of Jesus in this world. So excited to see you this morning. Happy Sunday.
Be thou my vision, O joy of my heart. Not be all else to me save that thou art. My calm in all strife, I ever with thee and thou in my life. Thou loving parent, thy child may I be, thou in me dwelling and I one with thee. Great God,
if we were gathered in our sanctuary at this point, we would invite us to a shift in the service. This shift for me is when we have our prayer, whether it's called prayer of assurance, centering prayer, prayer of confession. There's something about gathering the beginning of our service where we leave the past behind, we center into the present and are fully open to who we are and to whose we are. Later in our service, you're going to hear a text where Jesus offers a parable about prayer, where he reminds us that we should pray unceasingly or always. I don't think he means that we should be reading prayers all the time, but we should see life as a prayer. And he also reminds us to not lose heart, to be dedicated, to be committed to that vision, to that openness, to consciousness. So with all those words, I invite us to a few words and then the gift of silence. Will you join me as we pray? Spirit, we pause to commit to silence. We open our hearts. We open our minds. We open our hands. Be in our silence as we let go of the past and be present in this moment.
Yeah.
we gather our prayers as we sing the Lord's Prayer. One of the new discoveries I have had this week is discovering the old, discovering the reminder that God is dedicated to us, that God invites us to receive love and grace and forgiveness and compassion. And in knowing that and feeling that, we are then set free to be committed to live that compassion and justice in the world. So know this, we are loved, forgiven and set free. Thanks be to God for this great good news. Amen. You know, traditionally in a church, there is an opportunity to offer gifts. This is a way in which people are invited to respond out of their life experience, a way to say thank you by offering something to be used in this church, this community, and the world. And once the offering was, plates were passed, or people punched in the numbers on their phone or credit card, there is what's called a dedication. And the dedication is basically being saying something like this: this is set apart, this is holy, and it is also for the long haul work of the church. And so when we offer our gifts, they are dedicated, and they are dedicated to the life and work of the church. Offering is serious business, because it is saying, this is where my heart lies, and this is how I entrust you with those gifts. And so when you offer a gift to the church, we take it and faithfully serve those in this church, this community, and the world, and we dedicate it to God's love. So we invite you now to offer your gift so that your gift may be used in this church, this community, and around the world, dedicated to God's love. Amen.
Don't give up, it's just the weight of the world. When your heart's heavy, I will lift it for you. Don't give up, because you want to be heard. If silence keeps you, I will break it for you. don't give up. It's trust the hurt that you hide. When you're lost inside, I'll be there to find you. Don't give up because you want to burn bright. If darkness blinds you,
So today, John is looking at a story from our culture, a life text, as he calls it, a book called Dedicated. And so we look to scripture to see where in scripture does it talk about being dedicated and being persistent. This is the story, the parable of the widow and the unjust judge from Luke 18. Then Jesus told them a parable about their needs to pray always and not to lose heart. He said, in a certain city, there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected people. In that city, there was a widow who kept coming to him and saying, grant me justice against my opponent. For a while he refused, but later he said to himself, though I have no fear of God and no respect for anyone, yet because this widow keeps persisting and pestering and bothering me, I will grant her justice so that she may not wear me out by continually coming. And God said, listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not God grant justice to those who cry out to God day and night? Will God delay long in helping them? I tell you, God will quickly grant justice to them. And yet, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth? May the story of old enliven our living today.
As we gather for the sermon time, I invite us to pause and unite our hearts and minds in prayer that we might be open to the nudging of the Spirit. Let us pray. Spirit, as we breathe and as we commit to this listening, may our hearts be warmed, our minds be open, and our bodies engaged to a committed life. Be in our speaking this day. Amen. Last Saturday evening, I had a delightful dinner in downtown Calgary on 17th Avenue. It felt like normal. There were people out in the streets. And I sat down with Principal Richard Topping, who's a friend and colleague, the principal at Vancouver School of Theology. We had a chance, we hadn't seen each other for over 18 months, a chance to reconnect and talk about what COVID's been like, what's new at the school, how our lives are, our loves and our frustrations with theology and church and all the passions of life. And in the midst of this conversation, Richard told me about a book he is reading and how it was the latest greatest for him. And the book is called Dedicated, The Case for Commitment in the Age of Infinite Browsing. I love the title, Dedicated, The Case for Commitment in an Age of Infinite Browsing. And he told me that this is his latest greatest book because it's about teaching. It's about commitment. It's about realism. And so I Googled up Pete Davis when I got home and looked at his convocation speech. Pete Davis is a graduate of law at Harvard University. And in 2018, he did a speech, which I want to show you 3 minutes of right now, that talks about his passion for commitment or dedication. Here it is.
It's late at night, and you start browsing Netflix looking for something to watch. You scroll through different titles, you even read a few reviews, but you just can't commit to watching any given movie. Suddenly it's been 30 minutes and you're still stuck in infinite browsing mode, so you just give up. You're too tired to watch anything now, so you cut your losses and fall asleep. I've come to believe that this is the defining characteristic of our generation. Let's call it keeping our options open. Leaving home and coming here is a lot like entering a long hallway. You walk out of the room in which you grew up and into this place with thousands of different doors to infinitely browse. When Hollywood tells tales of courage, they usually take the form of slaying the dragon. It's all about the big, brave moments. The most menacing dragons that stand in the way are the everyday boredom and distraction and uncertainty that can erode our ability to commit to anything for the long haul. As I've grown older here, I've also started seeing the downsides of having so many open doors. Nobody wants to be stuck behind a locked door, but nobody wants to live in a hallway either. It's great to have options when you lose interest in something, but I've learned here that the more times I do this, the less satisfied I am with any given option. And lately, the experiences I crave are less the rushes of novelty and more those perfect Tuesday nights. When you eat dinner with the friends who you have known for a long time, who you've made a commitment to, and who won't quit you because they found someone better. We may have come here to help keep our options open, but I leave believing that the most radical act we can take is to make a commitment to a particular thing, to a place, to a profession, to a cause, to a community, to a person. To show our love for something by working at it for a long time, and to close doors and forego options for its sake. We need not be afraid, for we have in our possession the antidote to our dread, our time, free to be dedicated to the slow but necessary work of turning visions into projects, values into practices, and strangers into neighbors. We should pick a damn movie and see it all the way through.
This book is so awesome. I bought it on Monday. I've read it this week. It is a terrific book speaking about, I believe, our times, not just the COVID times, but the times we're living in right now. Dedicated is an attempt to make sense, someone writes, to show the commitment so often associated with conservatism and traditionalism is actually a radical act. Dedication is a radical act. In the book, Davis writes these words, which I think speak about this book and this time. Everything that matters takes time. There are no shortcuts. Teaching a student, advancing a cause, healing a divide, rectifying an injustice, revitalizing a town, solving hard problems, getting a new project off the ground all take time. When change takes time, we need something more. Something can get us through the boredom, distraction, exhaustion, and uncertainty that can plague any long-haul effort. And it is dedication. The book encourages us not to browse, but to be dedicated. Dedicated. The word dedication has two key meanings. The first is dedication means to make something holy. I'm sure you've had this opportunity when you've been out and about and you've come across a bench in our city and you sit down and there's a little plaque and it says, often dedicated in memory of someone, a reminder of the sacredness of this person and the beauty of this site. To dedicate means to make something holy. The second kind of dedication is to stick at something for a long time, to be dedicated with time for a long time. Pete Davis writes, we do something holy when we choose to commit to something. And in the most dedicated people I've ever met, I have witnessed how their pursuit of holiness comes with the side effect of immense joy. The side effect of immense joy. Have you ever experienced that when you've been dedicated to something and the joy of that completion? Maybe it's dedicated to a person, or dedicated to a cause, or dedicated to an institution. Perhaps it's when you thought you would quit and you stuck with it and you pursued through it and you achieved something great, a book study, a hobby, a practice. When I think about my work in ministry for 30 years, I've been dedicated to the church. I can't believe 30 years has gone so fast. My love-hate relationship with the church. Dedication involves both that struggle, that hate, and that joy. When have you experienced the joy of being dedicated to something? In the book, Davis talks about the fact that there's this sense in which we have this hallway, which he calls the browsing place, the culture of infinite browsing. And then off the side are these rooms, and the rooms signify a culture of commitment. He says, we're far more interested these days in staying in the hallway and just peeking in the door and closing it and peeking in the door and closing it and moving down the hallway rather than stepping into the room and committing. So he talks about the culture of infinite browsing, the hallway, and the culture of commitment, the rooms. You know, as you think about this, you know, and maybe you're feeling it in your body right now, there's lots of reasons why we don't want to commit. In the book, he said, yes, there are three main reasons we don't want to commit. The first is regret. If we commit to one option, and then you wake up one day, 20 years later, you wish you'd committed to something else. And there's an element of regret when we commit. The second is more familiar to us, fear of missing out. We realize if we commit to something, maybe we'll miss something better across the hallway in another room. The third, he says, the fear of association. Commitment threatens us because we might be identified with a group or the messiness when things go wrong. I see that so often in religion. People don't want to commit and say they're committed to religion because they know it will be messy and they're not sure if they can stick with it when things get messy. So Davis says we have a fear of commitment because of regret, of FOMO, fear of missing out, or association when things go sideways. I love this whole book and this idea because you know what? I'm a Teflon guy. I'm the kind of hummingbird I said a few weeks ago who loves to pop his head in different doorways, but not really commit to any one doorway. And here he's challenging me to say, what are you committed to? When have you been dedicated? When have you gone deeper and found the great joy that he writes and speaks about? You need to know this book is not a finger-wagging book telling you to put down your phone, rather inviting you to look in the mirror at your life. And I believe it is reflective of our times. In the book, he talks about what he calls long-haul heroes. And as we move into our hero series this coming week, this tweaked my imagination. What does he mean by long-haul heroes? And he looks at the the people through time who have been dedicated to their cause and the joy and the change they discover when they commit. The first one he talks about is Martin Luther King. Of course, we all can see and Martin Luther King doing his speech in Washington, but he says the years and years and years of commitment and dedication brought him to that moment to speak. Ordinary meetings, boring meetings in church basements over the years led to that pivotal moment of commitment and his speech. You see, Martin Luther King was someone who is dedicated to his cause over the long haul. Or think about Mr. Rogers. We've looked at sermons about Mr. Rogers. He did 905 episodes about educating kids about kindness and compassion. 905 episodes over the long haul, dedication to his cause. Or we look at activists like Rosa Parks, and we know that she's the one who sat down and people rose up, but we look at her life of years and years of boycotting and organizations. And she writes, "Sparks go nowhere without the long haul gathering of tinder." You see, her act that we know about had a grounding in the tinder of long haul work. Or more recently, Greta Thunberg. Yes, we know she's been popular in the last few years, but there were years earlier where she sat alone with a simple sign protesting climate change. You see, in leadership, there are often these long haul moments that nobody sees, but the person persists. And it's that dedication that he's talking about in this book. Perhaps in the truth and reconciliation efforts in Canada, we think of someone like Murray Sinclair, who led that organization over the long haul, the many years and the long hours of listening to the tragic stories of people comes down in a report that is released. The dedication over years leads to the statements that come in the end. It is the long haul that speaks about this great work. Or just think last week in Calgary. If you look, or in Alberta, I should say, look at the mayors who were elected in Calgary, of Jody Gondek or Jagmeet in Edmonton. Here are two people who are immigrants to Canada. Their roots are in India or Southeast Asia. And here these people have had jobs like driving a bus or working dedicated in school to receive a PhD. The two mayors in our two biggest cities have been there as long haul heroes, if you will, to now land in a great place to lead our province. The work through this COVID renewal is not a flick switch and go back to what was, but the long haul dreaming and imagination and hard work toward the future of our province. And I'm excited that these people will be leading us, as well as the councillors in both cities, men and women, who will lead us in the long haul. You see, these are long haul heroes we may know, but they're also long haul heroes right in our city. Perhaps it is the healthcare workers or the people working in restaurants, or long haul heroes who are single parents or dedicated hockey parents or healthcare workers or frontline workers, or the Alliance for the Common Good in Calgary that's worked so hard for the LGBTQ and the Green Line efforts. All of these efforts are the long haul heroes that take dedication. And I love that it's dedication, because it challenges me, the hummingbird who flits and fleets, to wonder about long haul commitment. So you're saying to yourself right now, hold on, I thought I clicked into a church. Surely this has to relate some way to the Bible. Well, yes, we hold the newspaper or the book in one hand and the Bible in the other and say, how do they come together? Well, here's the thing. The whole of the Bible is dedicated to people who were dedicated. The Hebrew story, the key story in the Torah for the Jewish people, is the story of movement from slavery to liberation. And when it is Moses, who is a long haul hero, who is called to lead the people, they wander in the wilderness for 40 years. That's a long haul, dedicated task. The people grumbled and complained. They wanted to go back into slavery, because at least in slavery they had food. And amidst the grumbling and complaining against Moses, he is dedicated to the cause that ultimately leads to liberation. So the whole story of the Hebrew people is about the dedication of various leaders along the way. The text that Sarah read a few moments ago is one I chose speaking about this very dedication. But something happened to me at 3 a.m. in the morning last night. First to the parable. You see, the parable is a story we often consider about a judge who is unattentive, but it's really about the widow. Jesus was telling parables, you see, because parables have many different points and they invite us to wrestle for the one that works. It begins, Jesus told them a parable about their need to pray always and to not lose heart. So Jesus wants the people to not lose heart. And in this story, you have this persistent widow who continually comes before the judge, knocking on the door, looking for justice, knocking on the door, looking for justice, knocking on the door, looking for justice. Her persistence and her dedication, the judge finally says, "She's worn me down," and offers her the justice she's been after. You see, the widow is dedicated to her cause. She is dedicated to justice. She is dedicated to changing the mind of the judge. So often in this story, we think of God as the judge, that if we can wear God down, God will finally give us what we want, like Santa Claus. But the reality and truth of the story is, I think God is the vulnerable widow in this story. Yes, you heard me right. God is the vulnerable widow dedicated in this story. You see, God is the one who's persistent, dedicated to the cause, which is us, dedicated to getting our attention. Even when we're texting or browsing, God is always trying to get our attention. Can you imagine just for a moment that God is always dedicated to you, always trying to get your attention, always there, even though you don't know it? Jesus was teaching about prayer. And in the middle of the night last night, I realized this. He isn't saying that we do prayer, that we read prayers. He says that we are in prayer. Because prayer isn't something we do. Prayer is something we are in. And therefore, we were always in prayer. Unceasingly is the phrase that is used. Everything we do is prayer. Our chores, our work, our lovemaking, our laughter, our anger, our frustration, all of that is prayer. And prayer is ultimately about consciousness. You heard a wonderful sermon last week from Don, who invited us to think of salvation as not personal, but corporate. There is unity. There is only one universal salvation. And as I thought of this at 3:30 in the morning, I was saying to myself that prayer is conscious union. Prayer is a bigger perspective. Prayer is connections. You see, prayer isn't about the right words. It is the practice of returning to consciousness, to presence, and to our truest self. Prayer, you see, is not something we do, it's something we are in. Our prayer life is keeping the eternal flame of God's love and purpose alive in our hearts to light our way. Nadia Boltz-Weber, a theologian, a radical theologian, you might say, writes these words, "Maybe prayer isn't the way in which we manipulate God, but it is simply the posture in which we finally become worn down by God's persistence or dedication, worn down by God's dedication in loving us, God's dedication in forgiving and being known, God's dedication in being faithful, and always, always, always God's dedication in bringing life out of death." I love the image of God as being the persistent, dedicated widow. Dedicated to us, dedicated to love, dedicating to creation, dedicated to us finding and discovering our truest self in our own skin. You know, it's not unlike when you are part of a, if you've traveled in Asia or part of a yoga community, you begin and end the session with the words namaste, which means the spirit in me greets the spirit in you. That is a pausing to recognize the people in the room are you, and you're connected one to the other. The spirit in me greets the spirit in you. You see, for me, God is both almighty, powerful, and all vulnerable. Both measure, mighty and vulnerable together, like the widow, the mighty widow who's dedicated to her cause. You see, I believe that this book, Dedicated, invites us to look in the mirror at how we want to browse and escape and be distracted. And we are called into the love and dedication of the God who loves us, who's dedicated to us, whose grace, forgiveness, and compassion is wide, holding us and lifting us to be dedicated and committed in our life. I love the idea that God is dedicated to us. And may we be to get dedicated to God and to one another, so that in our stepping forward, we know the love and laughter and joy and grace of being dedicated and committed. I'd love to know what you think about this book, but may you trust that we are loved, forgiven, and set free. Thanks be to God for God's great dedication. Amen.
Joy be in thy heart, peace be in thy spirit, compassion be thy journey, love be in thee. Joy be in my heart, peace be in my spirit.
You know, people wonder sometimes, how do we put all the pieces of the puzzle into Sunday morning? And it begins Monday. Mondays, we gather with people from various parts of leadership, lay people and staff people, to put together the pieces of the puzzle as we put together Sunday. And last Monday, when I talked about this book, Dedicated, we had a great conversation about the browsing culture and the commitment culture. And at the end of it, our gathering ended with Keith, our staff person for the Affirming Ministry, sharing a poem. And I'd like to invite him now to say something about that poem and share that this poem as a blessing for us as we move into a new week.
As we were planning this service, we had a really great conversation about dedication. And we had a good conversation about, you know, on one hand, do you dig many holes and maybe only get a few feet down and never strike water? And is it better to dig one deep hole and find water? Meaning staying dedicated to one path or one tradition or one practice. But on the other hand, if you don't dig a few holes, how are you ever going to find which path gets to water? How, if you commit to one hole and find that there's bedrock, you're not going to strike water. So we had a really great conversation about what does it mean to be dedicated? And I think an important part of what this is about is accepting that being dedicated sometimes doesn't mean that we'll ever see the end or we'll ever see things being finished. We all know what it's like to feel like we never finished a project or we have things hanging. But what if the Basileia to Theo, the kingdom of heaven, is something that we are all building in together? And though we may not see it in our lifetime, we will all see it one day. And so how do we trust in that? I came across this poem by Teilhard de Chardin from his book Hearts on Fire. And this is what he has to say. Above all, trust in the slow work of God. We are quite naturally impatient in everything to reach the end without delay. We would like to skip the intermediate stages. We are impatient of being on the way to something unknown, to something new. And yet it is the law of progress that it is made by passing through stages of instability and that it may take a very long time. And so I think with you, your ideas mature gradually. Let them grow. Let them shape themselves without undue haste. Don't try to force them on as though you could be today what time, that is to say grace, and circumstances acting on your own goodwill will make of you tomorrow. Only God could say what this new spirit gradually forming within you will be. Give our Lord the benefit of believing that his hand is leading you, and accept the anxiety of feeling yourself in suspense and incomplete. May we be at peace in the progress. May we find joy on the road. Blessings to you all. Amen.
Justice, kindness, walk humbly.
love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is God's faithfulness, O Lord. Great is your faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, great is your faithfulness, O Lord, great is your faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, O Lord. Great is your faithfulness.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the
steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, O Lord. Great is your faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, great is your faithfulness, O Lord, great is your faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness, O Lord. Great is your faithfulness.